Laura Sampere, perdón, Laura Dempere Marco. Ella es física, se doctoró en Londres en visión por computador y actualmente es profesora del Departamento de Tecnologías de la Información y de la Comunicación de la Universidad Pompeu Fabra. Su interés investigador se ha centrado en el procesamiento de la información visual en el cerebro y en su ponencia de hoy nos hablará de las aplicaciones del eye tracking en el estudio de la búsqueda visual y su rol en la determinación de la función cognitiva.
En primer lloc, vull agrair que m'hagin invitat a aquestes jornades. És un plaer ser aquí i sí que vaig a fer la xerrada en anglès, la tinc preparada en anglès, per tant, ara mateix canvi. Okay. This morning I'm going to be talking about eye tracking and how, in conjunction with visual search, they can be used as a hallmark of cognitive function. So first we should ask ourselves what eye tracking is. And eye tracking is the process of monitoring the position of our gaze and how the eye moves from one position to the other. And why do we need to move our eyes? We need to move our eyes because our visual system is such that the highest acuity that we have is only in a very small part of the retina, which is called the fovea, and from the fovea, the resolution of the image drops away. So in order to explore a visual scene, we need to move our eyes. And how do we measure it? There are a lot of devices which are able to do this, and they use different techniques. I'm going to be talking about this one, video oculography, because it's the one which is most commonly used. And basically what we have here is a subject who is looking at a screen, and basically we have here the eye tracker, which is a device that has an array of LEDs which are shedding light onto the eye and then measuring back the reflection of this light. And also, in the eye tracker, there is a camera which is capturing an image of the pupil, and the relative position of this reflection and the center of the pupil is giving us an idea of where the people are looking at in the screen. I also mentioned that I was going to be talking about visual search, and first we need to define what it is, and visual search is the act of looking for a target in a scene, and in psychophysics it's very commonly used in tasks such as this one, in which we need to look for a particular letter in an array of different letters, or also, for instance, in this case, we are looking for a horizontal red bar among a set of distractors. But really, I would like to invite you to think of visual search in a much broader way. So, for instance, visual search is something which we perform daily whenever we go, for instance, to the supermarket, as we have just heard. And basically, if we are about to buy a packet of biscuits, so we need to look for it and then just grab it. Also, it's not only very much used in our daily tasks, but it is used in several professional scenarios, and this is the case of, for instance, radiologists when they are assessing images of, for instance, in this case, the lung or the breast, or even whenever we go to an airport, our hand luggage is screened. And all of these processes require from the observer to scan the image and gather information about this image. In order to pursue this idea of understanding a bit better what visual search is, I would like to invite you to do a task, and the task is the following. I'm going to show you a card which contains a lot of rectangles, and all of these rectangles are split into parts, and all of them have a conjunction of two colors. But there is only one which contains the particular conjunction of these two colors, yellow and green. So I'll show it, and I would like you to think of what you are doing. Become aware of how you are trying to solve this task, okay? Please raise your hands whenever you're finished. Got a proportion of us having found it, so I'm going to tell you that it is in here. And I would like you to think whether you followed any strategy which is something like this. This is in fact a very common pattern, because whenever you don't have any queue in which you can rely on, it is optimal in a way to just scan the image, because in that way you are not forcing your working memory, you are just keeping track of what you've looked at by just following this scanning pattern, okay? But I'm gonna show you another image with the same task, and I would like you to appreciate that the scan path is very different in this case. And in this case, it's even more optimal than the previous one. And the reason why this is like that is because in this second case, we do have some features to make this search optimal and to rely on it. And we have analyzed it mathematically, and we've done it with the following result. In this card, the first one that I have shown to you, we have four different colors, but the probability that each of them appears in the card is exactly the same. Also, we have analyzed what the subject has looked at, and again, the probability of having looked at any color is exactly the same, just because it is the probability with which it appears in the image. So when you compare the two, there is no feature preference in this search. However, if you look at the other case, you will appreciate that there is a much less probability of having green in the card, so relying on this feature is going to help you a lot to find the target much quickly. In fact, this is the case in the scan path, in the visual scan path that the observer has followed, the probability that green appears is pretty much the same as in the other cases, but remember that it is very unlikely that it appears in the card, so by comparing these two informations, we have a huge peak of green being a very optimal characteristic. So really, we can do this when we have the complete scan path, but also that's something we can monitor dynamically, and that's something that we can find here. So here, what we are looking at is really the dynamic emergence of the pattern. So for instance, we could assess patients by seeing how optimal they are at developing or not the strategy of relying on green, and also on how fast they are in developing this strategy. Actually, eye movements have been used for very many years. This is one of the classical studies by Jarbus. And in this case, what Jarbus is showing is that whenever we observe a scene, we have the information itself, but also we have all our prior expectations about what the scene is telling us. So for instance, if we ask the person to do a free search, we have a pattern like this, but whenever we ask people to do a particular task, for instance, give the ages of the people, then there will be some regions of the image which are going to be privileged. So the eye movements do have a lot of information, first about the image and also about our intentions on the image. So there is really a lot of data which we can explore from there. And that's what I'm going to do for the rest of the talk. So basically, for a few years now, I've been working in analyzing this eye movement in different tasks, and together with my colleagues, I've come up with a conceptual framework in which we analyze the sequence of spatial locations and the features that people are looking at in these spatial locations. We also have developed methods to establish which features are salient or have some priority to solve the task. And then all of this together will give us the dynamics of this oculomotor action. And really, a point which I would like you to appreciate also is that the structure of this conceptual framework very much resembles the neurophysiology of our visual pathway, having the information entering the visual field from V1 and then going towards the dorsal stream or the ventral stream, analyzing what we have in the image, where we have in it, and the connection between the two streams. Keeping this in mind, now I would like to revisit this question of why visual search. Visual search is a very fundamental process in visual information processing, and it is very useful because it's involved in a lot of tasks that we perform daily. And also, it offers an experimental paradigm which allows us to obtain fundamental understanding of how we process visual information in a way that by just designing different tasks, we will be able to probe different aspects of cognition, like object recognition, visual saliency, visual attention, decision making, visual memory, and so on and so forth. Okay. First, I'm going to try to, in a way, surprise you, because I'm going to talk about a task or a kind of or a set of tasks which have nothing to do with neuropsychology to start with. But I'd like to convey this idea that you do have a lot of information in this pattern. So once we know how to extract it, then we can move into the neuropsychological domain and explore it in this domain. So now we are going to be looking at how do you gather information from radiological images. We did have some radiologists looking at the images, and they had to give a diagnosis from them. And basically, these are the patterns that we have on these images. These are CT images of the lung. And when we put together the data from different observers, what we find is that this data in this particular study tend to cluster in four specific positions. So now with this, we know where people are looking at when they are trying to give a diagnosis. But we do have a lot of data. We have dynamical data, so we also know how people have looked at this. So we know where they have looked and how they have compared this information that they have in here. But also coming from the computer vision community, we know how we know what kind of information that they are exploring in these regions, so we can learn all these features which are important to come up with a diagnosis. And that's what we did by making use of a mathematical technique called factor analysis. So all in all, with this, what we can have is information about what people look at in which locations and how they compare these locations. So what is the take-up message of this? Basically, we learned these strategies, and we try to understand whether these strategies are valuable. And then we train people with no training whatsoever about radiology. So these were students who haven't studied any medicine. And we asked them, look at these images in this way and give us a diagnosis. We extracted the knowledge from the radiologists. They didn't say anything. They just looked at the images. And the results were the following. We had that when they were just looking at the images with any prior information, the CT images as such, three possible diagnoses, all of them performed pretty much at random level. However, when they were trained with these strategies that we have learned, all the accuracies of the diagnosis almost doubled. So really there is information which we can gather from these patterns of five movements. I'm going to give you another example of how this can be exploited. And again, with radiologists, we have a set of images, radiologists looking at them, computer imaging techniques in order to extract the kind of features which are relevant, which are texture features in this case. And by doing something very similar to the trick that I was playing with you with the cart, we can see what's the prevalence of a particular feature in the image compared to what the people have done, and then see whether there is any particular feature which is guiding the search. And in this case, there is a region of these features which is relevant, and we find that if in the images we look for those features which have these values, we can map out what are the relevant images, the relevant parts of the image which are valid for diagnosis. We can compare and combine the evidence from different observers. And in the end, we come with a map of regions which are of importance in diagnosis. And this is very much correlated with the behavior of experts in independent images. So we can learn all of this. How can we take it into the neuropsychological domain? That's the question I will tackle now. From now, I've basically been discussing how to use these knowledge gathering techniques in medical image understanding, but we can replicate it in neuropsychology. And specifically in neuropsychology, I will add another component, which is the neurodynamical modeling, because we know the structure of the different parts of our brain, and we can do models of several functions. I will be discussing, for instance, working memory. Okay? So, in terms of eye tracking, we did a first study analyzing the reading patterns of children with dyslexia. And what we found was that we really wanted to do an intervention on these children, such that when they were reading some images, some text, we tried to change those words which are less frequent for words which are more, sorry, I don't see it well, the words which are less frequent and therefore more difficult to read, with words which are more frequent and then easier to read, but keeping exactly the same meaning, okay? And basically, when we do this intervention, what we see is that the children read this text in less time, and also the duration of the fixations was less. And when compared with a healthy population, we see that it moves in the right direction. So it's going towards this direction of having less reading time and a smaller fixations. Okay. In terms of computational neuroscience, we work in modeling a function, working memory, which, I don't think that I have to say much about what it is in here, so I'll just skip that bit. But in terms of neurophysiology, there have been some studies from Fuster, basically in the 70s, who stated that a neural correlate of working memory can be the persistent activity in a delay matched to sample task in prefrontal cortex, okay? And we have developed some methods based on this paradigm, which I'm not going to discuss, but it basically gives us a network of thousands of neurons which are interconnected with each other, and they are biophysically plausible models. And with that, we have been able to reproduce some experimental results. And the results are the following. Basically, when we have this experimental paradigm, starting with a fixation, we show subjects a card with several items, and we are assessing working memory capacity. So we need to know, out of these items, how many of them are remembered after retrieving the scene. Okay? And we have added an issue here of making some of them more visually salient, such that we can prove how attention is engaged in this task. And with healthy young people, what is observed is that the number of items that is kept during the delay period goes down. Compared with the case in which we don't have any saliency, we normally are able to keep up to four items in memory. And the salient items are kept in memory at the cost of not keeping so many non-salient items. These experiments have done with healthy controls, but we are planning to do it with patients, because this is a very useful tool to see how this attention is really affecting working memory. We have put together a neurodynamical model, as I said, just several thousand neurons interacting with each other, and we are able to reproduce the dynamics of the neuronal responses. So now we know in detail why is it that this number of objects that we are keeping during this delay period is lower. And this opens up also the possibility to analyze what could be the possible effect of several treatments, pharmacological treatments, because if we know how they affect in the neurons, we can model it. And, okay. So all in all, what we've done is put together all of these ideas in a national project, which is running from last year. And the objective in neuropsychology is the following. We do have expertise in computational modeling in the area of computational neuroscience. We do have expertise in computer vision and data analysis. So we can put together experimental and computational studies which complement each other. So from the computational side, we can do models of decision making, perceptual decision making and working memory, and see what is the interplay with visual attention. And this, in fact, will be experimental results which we can check with patients. Also, from the point of view of data analysis, we can put together computerized neuropsychological tests together with eye tracking and explore this wealth of data, and I will show you some of the results that we have so far. And also we can try to develop novel experimental designs which exploit specifically those functions in which we are interested. With all of this, the idea is to develop diagnostic tools and also being able to monitor the process of aging and possibly, if the applications are fancy enough, to have some cognitive training out of them. So let me show you the idea. This is as a part of this social impact in developing diagnostic tools, we are collaborating with Hospital Clinic, and in particular with the group led by Dr. Lorena Rame, in the idea of trying to characterize preclinical stages of Alzheimer's disease. Today, we've heard a lot of interesting talk about these stages, and the idea is really to try to develop, or at least to exploit, some of these tests which are already available and try to see whether with the data that we have from eye tracking, we can really distinguish now the preclinical stages. And I will show you some of these ideas in here. Basically, all of you are familiar with this TMTA card. And here, what you will see is the performance of a subject who did this. Of course, when they are doing this, the task, these yellow lines are not there. This is just for you to track where the positions are. And you will see some interesting patterns that you can encapsulate from the eye tracking data. This is what a patient does, and you will see that when he finds number one, then quickly finds number two and three, but then go back to one and two. And that's something that when you only have the time that it takes to complete the card is absolutely missing. So really we do have a lot of data here about not only how long it takes to solve the task, but also why is it that it takes that time? How optimal is this patient in exploiting his or her working memory? Is he able to see that if you've visited three before finding two, when you find two, you will remember that three is there? All of these aspects are in the data, and we can look into it with a lot more detail than we were able to look at it in the past. Here you have some results, very preliminary. I just really want to keep this as very preliminary because we don't have too many subjects. But basically we have here some subjects who have undergone the punction of CSF fluid, so we know whether they have positive and negative biomarkers. And in the TMTA, what we see, for instance, in this graph is that the time it takes to find the next number goes down, as it is obvious, because you have taken out information which you don't need to look for anymore. Once you are in five, you don't need to look for four again. Okay? And in here, there are no differences between the positive and the negative cases. We have actually modified the TMTA to put the numbers in random locations, and in this case, it is even more clear that there is a benefit from having found the previous numbers, and again, there is no difference, so why I am showing this? The idea is that really the velocity of processing doesn't seem to be affected, but what happens if we have more complex tasks as the one that you have performed before? Here we have an example again. And this is how this task is solved in real time. In here, the goal is to find yellow and black. And here you have it, okay? So when we now compare again the behavior of positive and negative, in this case, we see that the completion time, although in the beginning when we have, here you have the color prevalence, so here the four colors appear with the same probability, but we can manipulate it to make the task easier. And you see that in the positive population, there is no learning of the task. Basically, it doesn't matter what's the prevalence of the color. There is exactly the same strategy in all the occasions. However, for the negative population, we have a learning. So whenever the task becomes easier, the completion time also becomes faster. And in terms of oculomotor motions, for instance, what we can see is that, again, there is no much change in the mean saccadic length of the distance between two eye movements. So very much what happens in here is that the positive population is just looking in with smaller saccades, doing a very systematic exploration of the image, and whenever the target is found, it's found. Not exploiting the possibility to perform longer saccades and find the target in a much quicker way. Okay, so these are very preliminary, but I just wanted to illustrate this potential to really explore all the wealth of data that we have. In terms of neurodynamical modeling, we can also analyze tasks such as perceptual decision making. Here we have the task in which we would have a random of dots moving in random directions with a 0% of coherence or different levels of coherence. Of course, in this case, it's obvious that the motion is upwards, and in this case, there is no net motion. So here we can explore the basis of how decisions are made on the basis of what positions are being looked at. And these are also experiments that we are planning to conduct in the same way as I was mentioning about working memory, to explore it with patients. So all in all, how to transfer all of this knowledge to neuropsychology? The idea is to either design or adapt those tasks that we already have, but look at it with this new perspective that this wealth of data provides. We have a spatiotemporal data with high time resolution, which is 1 to 20 milliseconds, and a very high spatial accuracy of over 0.5 degrees. And also, combining it with neurocomputational models, we are able to have new experimental evidence that we haven't been exploring before. And a final point which I would like to address here in the community of neuropsychologists is that up to now, these devices, the eye trackers, were extremely expensive. We were talking about 30,000 euros. But the market is now exploding, and really, we have eye trackers with about 300 euros. And the technology is here for really including it in smartphones and tablets. In fact, there are already some eye tracking facilities in smartphones, but they are not so accurate yet. But the future is there, the technology is here, and in a few years it will be in place, so I don't think it's too far that we will be seeing that these tasks are really encoded in tablets, and then we can have all of this wealth of data. And then we just need the analytical tools to find the information out of here. So with that, I'd like to finish with this picture, which to me is very inspiring. By combining these two approaches of computer vision and eye tracking with computational neuroscience, we can have a very nice insight into how our brain processes visual information. Thanks for your attention.